On the dawn of Comic-Con and the insane announcement of Phase 4 of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, the future for Marvel and its characters are set in stone. The Marvel gaming universe is not quite yet on that level, with two action RPG Marvel games coming within a year of each other. Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3 is the latest console Marvel title and finds itself in a bit of a weird spot. It has the distinction of being the first major game after Marvel's Spider-Man, and it's launching in the shadow the newly announced Marvel's Avengers Next Generation title has already cast since its E3 reveal. On top of all that, Marvel Ultimate Alliance is a long-running franchise that spans more than a decade and comes with its own legacy to either uphold or let down. Thankfully, Ultimate Alliance 3 delivers one of the best games in this long-running series. One of the biggest differences between the games are the people developing it. This franchise was started by the incredible team at Raven Software. Their presence was missing from Ultimate Alliance 2, and the franchise was left dormant for years, seemingly never to return. This all changed when Nintendo, of all companies, announced it would be returning, this time with Team Ninja developing it as a Switch-exclusive title. So many questions were asked, and ultimately the biggest mystery was how this game would live up to its long legacy, and how much would they change for the modern era. Thankfully, Team Ninja seems to have a pretty strong memory, and the talented team wisely went back and studied what worked and what didn't. Right away, the game's visual style is striking, and it's a hard turn from Ultimate Alliance 2's more realistic but very drab visual style. Vibrant, cel-shaded, and comic-inspired character designs are back and fully embraced from top to bottom. Each character represented feels like a deliberate throwback to their best self. Even on the underpowered Switch, the game does a great job of balancing its visuals with keeping the game playable with multiple camera options and action that's easy to follow despite the chaos. Despite the huge change in developers, the core combat is actually pretty similar in style. Four heroes run around linear environments, beating up whatever nameless henchmen that chapter's location and villain can provide. From escaped Wrath prisoners or the Hand's endless army of ninja, the game has no problem throwing dozens of these enemies at you before your eventual showdown with each chapter's major boss fight. Surprisingly, the combat is a bit simpler in terms of combo depth than the previous games. Each character only has one combo string, one air attack, and one heavy attack. This is a bit stripped down from the previous games that had several combo strings with unique effects such as launchers or knocking enemies down. It's a bit of a letdown because Team Ninja's work on several Musou titles have shown them capable of delivering a massive roster with a huge variety of combo attacks, so the stripped down approach is felt pretty early on. As you play for longer periods of time, the simplicity really hampers the overall combat depth. The character abilities, however, fare a bit better, with each hero's four powers usually having several different elemental and combat effects that will reward players who take advantage of them properly. One of the new mechanics this game introduces are the concepts of synergy attacks. Every ability in the game has synergy with every other character's abilities, and using them at the proper time can lead to devastating effects. They also look very flashy and are vital to being effective, especially in the harder difficulty settings. Most enemies and bosses have a new mechanic known as a stagger gauge. Underneath the health bar, this new stagger gauge will slowly fill, and when it does, that enemy is staggered, allowing you precious time to hit them hard with your strongest abilities. If you use a synergy attack on a staggered enemy, they become stunned, take more damage, and they take a much longer time to recover. Learning each character's combo potential, their abilities, and how they synergize, and bouncing around the field or battle staggering enemies and stunning them at the right time, really makes up for the lost combat depth in terms of each character's combo potential. Also returning from the older games are super moves. Each character comes with a unique super move, and like the regular abilities, these super moves can be changed with your team to unleash some insane frames-dropping shenanigans. The story is also really well done. Now, it's not on the level of one of the Marvel films, but it doesn't need to be. They do a really great job of keeping the pace brisk and moving forward, taking the player from one Marvel location to another. This style of storytelling can usually lead to its own set of problems, and the last thing anybody wants is to feel like the game is just a museum tour. But they sidestep that issue perfectly. With Thanos and the Infinity Stones causing chaos, they always manage to find a decent reason to have the game move from place to place. It's a fan service game, don't get me wrong, but it's well done and it comes to a satisfying conclusion. When the story is complete, players have access to harder difficulty settings, and the roster is so large you can spend tons of hours getting every character maxed out. On top of the campaign, Infinity Trials provide a fun set of challenge missions with a large variety of goals and a 3-star scoring system. Everything from characters, costume colors, and ISO 8 gear pieces are unlocked in these trials, and they can even be played online with your friends. Speaking of the online, it works perfectly. Here's how it's set up. If I host a game, my friends can join me using the Join a Friend option. Let's say two friends join me. When they hop into my game, they will pick one character from their own roster to bring in with them. I will manage the remaining two spots on the team as if I was playing solo. Everything those players do will return with them back into their own save. Every bit of XP, money, gear, and even story progression will travel back with them. This makes for a far better online experience than the franchise has ever had, and the game performs admirably with very little rubber banding or noticeable lag, even on Wi-Fi. The game as a whole, though, isn't perfect. Besides the lack of combo depth, the camera when playing locally can get stuck in seemingly random spots, and that can be very frustrating. In portable mode, the game can also have some frame drops during the more chaotic moments, but thankfully that's limited to things such as four characters performing a team ultra, or when the camera pulls back for a big set piece moment, so it's not as detrimental as it could have been. And despite those shortcomings, Team Ninja has done a fantastic job bringing Marvel Ultimate Alliance back for the modern era. Their obvious love and attention to the Marvel Universe, and most importantly the franchise that they have inherited, shows in all aspects. They've also announced a long list of updates coming to the game, ranging from costumes, characters, and even more story chapters. It's not perfect, but Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, The Black Order, restores a legacy of this great action RPG franchise with this strongest entry yet. I give Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, The Black Order an 8.3. It is a great game, a ton of fun to play locally, online. If you love the franchise or you're a brand new player, you can't go wrong. I hope everyone enjoyed the review. Check out the written one at rectifygaming.com. I am Dave, aka Namtox, and I hope everyone has a great time out there. See you for the next review. Have a good one, everybody.